Great. Thanks, everybody, for joining us this morning, just before lunch. I am Kevin McPartland. I'm the head of market structure and technology research at Greenwich Associates. We're a financial markets-focused research and advisory firm. We're going to talk about liquidity. We can't have a conference in financial markets these days, probably for the last 5 years, without having at least one panel on liquidity. So we're going to sort of dive into that topic and hopefully come up with some new and interesting nuggets for everybody through the discussion. Before we get started, if I can just ask each of the panelists, and there are a lot of them, to quickly introduce themselves, talk a little bit about your role, and then we'll get started.
Good morning, I'm Nicolas Bertrand, the head of derivatives for London Stock Exchange Group.
My name is Chris Edmonds. I'm Senior Vice President for Financial Markets at Intercontinental Exchange.
I'm Keith Fish. I'm a Managing Partner at Trade Forecaster Global Markets. We're a small proprietary trading firm providing resting orders in the futures market space.
Jonah Platt, a Director in the Government and Regulatory Policy Team at Citadel.
Antonio Reyes, America Head of Futures Clearing and Collateral Management for Citigroup.
John Shea, Global Head of FIC, NASDAQ.
So this is obviously an educated audience, so we don't need to get into the basics of what liquidity is, but Keith, you and I spoke a little bit earlier about sort of how that definition has changed as we've been changing our thinking over the last few years. Maybe you can talk a little bit about, you know, how we should think about liquidity in this context before we dive deeper.
Sure. You know, there's a lot of comments that have come out on the issue of liquidity, and I think if we kind of, you know, think about it and apply some common sense, you know, liquidity is really when two parties basically find themselves in the marketplace and transact at mutually agreed prices and quantities. And if we apply that definition, if we think about liquidity in that way, it's not really a qualitative aspect of markets. It's booming. It's either there's liquidity or there's no liquidity. And I think if we take that framework, it kind of can guide our discussion quite well.
That's great. And so maybe if we start with the exchanges, whoever wants to raise their hands first, but obviously that is your business by and large, right, is being a center of liquidity. So maybe talk a little bit about how it applies.
I mean, 10 years ago, we had a financial crisis, and we were all here at this conference talking about, you know, what that means for the OTC derivative market, what that means for clearing, what that means for liquidity. The ultimate end goal is to find that liquidity. And we got through the financial crisis. There was an enormous amount of regulatory, what you could argue is overreach. And it really impaired many people's, or certainly market participants' ability to rely upon what we felt was the traditional way of discovering and executing in the OTC markets, because the whole idea of putting things on a listed venue came screaming to the forefront. Everyone felt that if you could discover and execute on a listed exchange or a listed venue, things that are like now known as SEFs or MTFs in Europe, and then there would be a straight-through process into a clearing mechanism. It would provide surety and safety as well as access for all. That was 10 years ago, and the risks associated with the overreach of regulation had definitely had an impact on the OTC markets, but it has definitely raised the profile of the listed space, and I don't think that has ever been more true than what we see in the listed future space.
I think it's a very good that we talk about it today, because when we talk to the buy side, it's definitely a topic. Liquidity is on the top of the agenda, and I think it's because there has been a shift really in the last years, whereby the market is dealing with a more fragmented financial markets with lots of trading venues. On some occasions, for instance, in Europe for equities, you got about 30 trading venues where you need who you need to interact with. And at the same time, the market has concentrated. So you got less intermediaries, less liquidity providers. So a bit more of a difficult liquidity profile. And this has created, therefore, a change of the meaning of liquidity. And I think as exchanges, we are market infrastructure providers, and we need to look at that and innovate. And what we did, for instance, at the London Stock Exchange, and Turquoise in particular, in equities, is first of all working a lot more with the clients, involving the buy side, the sell side, and the liquidity providers, up to the point that we formed a partnership with the buy side and the sell side. It's called the Plato partnership that we signed a year ago. And we went on and developed new functionalities, new market models that allow clients to deal with that sort of liquidity gap, and particularly the need for size, because you've got to remember that the buy side as well at the same time is becoming as well more concentrated. 10 years ago, it was difficult to talk to a hedge fund that was over 10 billion of assets under management. Nowadays, there are many of them, and even 10 times that size. So you've got these, these big clients that need to trade in size. And so the functionality we introduced is called Turquoise Block Discovery, and it basically allows the market, the buy side and the sell side, to interact in an environment that is managed by a regulated exchange, and whereby they're able to put their trades, their high size trade, being protected from information leakages. And that sort of functionality has grown very, very significantly this year, moving from 200 million euros of activity per month to 2.3 billion last month. So we see that when there is an innovative spirit of the exchange, and more importantly, a partnership work with the clients, that you succeed to provide for new ways to answer to that question of search for liquidity. And that's positive for the market.
John reminded us when we set up here a little bit earlier that this room is far more full yesterday at the same time slot, but it changed later panel. So, but one thing that was brought up during that panel yesterday was the number of services the exchange infrastructure providers may need to take on and think about. And while it is certainly the case that the fragmentation in the marketplace has created the need for innovation, I think we're at the beginning of that curve, not at the end, nor near the end. And one example I'd point out is if you look at some of the index trades that go on right now today between sell side desk and buy side firms that may go on forever, and you have the input of the uncleared margin rules coming past. Now they have to pay and collect margin from the client on one side, they're hedging the underlying instruments in the basket on the other side using future instruments or other things in the listed space. They're having to pay margin on that side. The opportunity for that transaction to continue to be profitable is going to be continued to be challenged under the impact of these rules. So I think there will be a fair amount of innovation from many of my colleagues up here and ourselves included over the coming months and years to find ways to recreate that same economic benefit that both sides of the market are looking to achieve, and at the same time do it within a capital formation that is something that doesn't require everyone to run away from it. And that's not necessarily the easiest pathway to get to at the end of the day, but we're not here to dislocate the marketplace. However, we all have to realize the evolution of the market and the change that it's caused, as John pointed out, because of the crisis. While there are smaller, there's a concentration of positions, as Nicholas said, you still have this issue where people are looking under every rock. And when they look under every rock to find the liquidity they were accustomed to getting in the previous and before the crisis, that tailored piece of it's not there.
So Chris, what's the innovation? Is it technology? Is it protocols? Is it new market models? I mean, what is the innovation?
From my opinion, I think it's all of the above. I think there'll be new instruments to come out. I think there are new workflows that we have to consider. And if you look at a traditional buy-side client, not many of them used the full gamut of the futures industry over their history, right? So, if you look at how they manage the portfolio, where they see the accounting systems they have, all of that will be impacted at some form or fashion over time. And as we continue to, as an industry, evolve the product space, well, there's a daisy chain effect that is impacted there, and that requires new technology. We talked yesterday on the Exchange Leader Panel, we talked about how does blockchain come into that, and where do those opportunities present themselves? Faster settlement, we need faster settlement. I think we all agree we can do faster settlement today. There hasn't been a desire to go down that path. And now this new technology company is like, everybody, we got to go find out what the new fastest way to do that is. I'm not exactly sure that's either a problem looking for a solution or a solution looking for a problem, depending on what time of day you're having the conversation.
Antonio, what's that look like from an investor, FCM perspective for you? Are you seeing that innovation in those changes?
Well, I think it's important to separate the sources of liquidity from the technology that we use to tap into those sources of liquidity. right? So if you look at the past 10 years, how regulation has shaped that market structure and how the market structure has impacted liquidity. 10 years ago, the definition of liquidity, if you look at the futures market on a monolithic basis, it was an ADV, open interest, bit of a spread. You take a quick look and you can tell whether or not that thing is liquid, right? Then we start evolving. Cash equity markets evolved much quicker with Reg NMS and MiFID and everything else, and then depending on which venue you look at, that contract or that stock can be liquid or not. That process has started to take place now with the likes of NFX and so on, where you now have choice. So once again, if you forget about liquidity and about bringing sources of liquidity together by leveraging technology, depending on what you're looking at, you might define a contract to be liquid or illiquid. And then the last, and I guess the same applies to an extent to execution of swaps. Same swap, if you look at a CEF, you go, this thing is not trading. Just speak to a tier one as a manager, you go, super liquid. And send three RFQs, and add it, whatever liquidity I want. Right? And then the last derivative of this iterative process is the concept of clearing liquidity, which was again, we just used to clear, but that's no longer the case because take, for example, a peso-denominated swap. You're a West Coast asset manager trading to a tier one dealer in New York, will mean that the CME no problem will clear it. If your local pension plan clear with the local clearinghouse in Mexico, you have a limited number of counterparties that you can tap into. So your concept of liquidity of that contract changes dramatically, obviously. So I guess the question is, how are we leveraging technology available to bring that liquidity together to the best of our ability?
And Jonah, maybe I'll turn it over to you. I mean, as Antonio pointed out, access has certainly improved, choice has improved. In theory, choice would help liquidity, but then on the other hand, has it just fragmented and made things so complicated that we have many more pockets of less liquidity as opposed to a few big pockets of deep liquidity?
Right, so I think, first of all, when we talk about liquidity, it's important to really focus in on specific asset classes. So the liquidity characteristics for, you know, cleared interest rate swaps are much different than the liquidity characteristics for off-the-run treasuries, for example. I think taking cleared interest rate swaps as an example first, we've seen the combination of market reform and market innovation help liquidity in that market. Talking about central clearing, straight through processing, increased transparency, CEF trading. The data shows, according to the Bank of England, which put out a paper last summer, liquidity has improved as a result of the implementation of those reforms for cleared interest rate swaps. Now, liquidity for off-the-run treasuries needs more work. As an example of, where further market innovation is required, we think, innovations such as an expansion of repo clearing would be quite beneficial for that segment of the market. So it comes back to really focusing in on the characteristics that are relevant for each particular asset class when discussing, the broader concept of market liquidity.
I think as well there is this very important point of capital, right? And I was very positively impressed by the speech of Chairman Giancarlo yesterday, where he recognized in a certain way that the market, the number of market players have exited the market because they couldn't, from a regulatory standpoint, justify that business anymore. And that has impacted liquidity because you are reducing the number of players actively participating in the markets. But capital can also be seen as something where exchanges can deliver some value add, thinking in particular in the clearing and the post-trade, whereby obviously you are dealing with a number of markets because of fragmentation, but you can, at the back end in post-trade, provide for centralization and portfolio margining. to allow the market to be able to deal with these products using less capital. That's a bit what we did with Curve Global, which is the offering of fixed income derivatives in Europe, with the very interesting value added, which is the possibility to benefit from portfolio margining with SwapClear in ACH. So actually the client at the end of the day is able to merge the positions of listed derivatives and of the OTC swap business that they do.
Can we go back to some things that came up in the discussion? And that's, the nomenclature that we've been using for many, many years is the, buy side, sell side. And I think in some asset classes, as Jonah pointed out, the division of asset classes really changed the conversation. Is there really a distinction in buy side and sell side, like in the futures markets? Are the tools and technology that were traditionally used by liquidity providing firms finding their way in the hands of asset managers and others and changing kind of the look and feel of their transaction behavior to the point that, maybe we won't be using those terms later to distinguish them?
I mean, are there, and this goes back to the point about capital, are there structural advantages to non-bank liquidity providers now in the markets because they're not, they don't have to deal with a lot of the same costs and regulations that the larger banks do?
I think that brings up kind of two issues. One is cost structure of firms, right? I worked in a large bank for a long time, and you have these dreaded annual meetings to talk about allocated cost, right? So if you were high profitability area in the bank, all of a sudden your allocated cost went up to cover something else. But innovative trading opportunities in large bank, they come, they up, from kind of time, and the bank makes a lot of money. And then you see other market participants kind of enter and take away the edge because they have lower cost structure. And I think that, especially in our futures markets, we see a lot of market participants with very optimized cost structures able to provide liquidity and because of kind of allocated costs and managerial accounting in larger institutions, it's hard for them to compete. That said, I think there's room for everybody. It's a great pretty level playing field in the future. So.
I think to your point around the structural advantages for non-bank market makers, and I would say indirectly, they are going to be impacted, I would think so, as much as every other participant, because at the end of the day, they need to find someone to clear these things for them. Right? And the key for an efficient electronic market making operation is to keep your costs as low as you can. As a bank FCM, they have limited capacity, both primarily from capital, but also from a balance sheet point of view, which didn't used to be the case 10 years ago. Right? So I'm going to have to look at that capacity, how do I allocate it, and more importantly, how do I price it? Right? And the days of being able to price a market maker at a center of two, because I just have computational power, so no, those days are very gone, I think.
Yeah, bank. I'm sorry, Chris. I know you've been trying to get
a word. I disagree. How about that?
Not that shocking. So look, we all need banks to act as traditional risk transfer agents. It works. It kind of keeps the ecosystem, the global markets, kind of moving. We went through a crisis, and banks were curtailed because of the enormous stresses and the regulatory burdens that were thrust upon them. You had the rise of non-banks as a natural adapter to opportunity. And yes, they can control costs better than the large banks because, well, by their very nature, they're somewhat unregulated, although many of them do trade across asset classes, so they do are either direct members of certain clearinghouses or venues or self-regulatory organizations, so they're not completely free of regulation. But they can work very effectively side by side. Banks have large clients, they have balance sheet, they have information, they provide a myriad of, they lend money to their clients, they provide financing, margin finance, they do all sorts of cool things that non-banks can't do. I mean, Jonah speaks directly to the point about off the run and on the runs. Citadel has a very powerful franchise across asset classes, and they certainly have made a name and reputation for themselves in going after those very difficult, what would be perceived prior to the crisis as bespoke, and people would view it, I think the mass public would view it as somewhat highly illiquid products. But now that they're clearing, I think again to one of the points the panelists have made, now they can compete alongside the traditional banks in some of these particular asset classes. The point about off the run should not be lost on this audience. It's a real issue, especially with the pile of debt that we keep on issuing, that there should be a much more liquid and transparent, hopefully clearable way for off the runs to discover and execute. I know Jonah and his company are doing the best they can to create impact and change that. But the point I'm trying to make, in a very roundabout way.
I told you I disagree.
I think Keith made the comment in his opening remarks in that liquidity used to be between, you know, it is between two points, right? But you do have these non-banks that have multiple logins and multiple API identifiers, and you have this scope that can now be brought to rather small, from a headcount point of view and cost point of view, firms. The banks have clearly caught up to that now that we're at the other side of the financial crisis. And you're starting to see the results of that, which are really good results in earnings, which have just been reported for the last quarter, which tells me that things are working in a nice way. Obviously, when we've had bouts of volatility going backwards from the Trump election to the Brexit vote, and then you can go back to, you know, Swiss National Bank and the flash rally. Look, yes, the market moved in numerous volatility stretches during those periods of trading hours, but liquidity was there. And I was working at a non-bank at the time. I remember very few trades being broken during some of these very dramatic moves. Obviously, the Swiss National Bank was a slightly different shocker, but and there were a couple of a couple of breaks there. But the point is that you were able to find, or for the non-bank bankers, you were able to create and be able to and get acted upon throughout the day. A sure testament that the liquidity backbone that has been in place across asset classes, and maybe we're learning some of this from the equity experience, is starting to drip into the other asset classes, certainly in futures, in a way that makes sense, I think, for all participants.
Chris, I think it's finally your turn.
Sorry.
Part of that I have to agree with. So if you look at the markets prior to the crisis and what we would call the normal market, right? You're a large asset manager, you pick up the phone, you're an asset manager, having a relationship, you pick up the phone, you can pick up the phone to multiple banks, multiple sell-side institutions. We bring the two together, Keith. We can pick up the phone. You can have a price made to you, and you make your decision. You put the position on or not. Now you don't have the same number of relationships. That reduction in the relationships you have, you're able to maintain given the amount of finite capital you as a trading institution have. And so now you're having to find other ways to achieve the same economic benefit. And those other ways to achieve the same economic benefit through listed products offers great standardization of what those products are. By definition, futures products are standard products. By definition, the market have become accustomed to trading very tailored positions. That was their edge. If you look at the index business, that's why you have all the index calculation agents that are out there coming up with, you know, here's how I'm going to slice the pie in one given way. So it actually takes both now to do the job that before, you know, sell side institution made the price, asset manager took it, sell side institution comes into the futures market, hedged the risk, you know, I'm gonna call it a fairly simplistic form at that, and that was the depth of liquidity now. Now the other side's having to find their way in because they either can't get that level of service because of the concentration we've all mentioned, or we get to a point where the capital is so punitive to put that trade, to continue to have that trade on, they're willing to accept some level of basis risk in their portfolio in order to have some idea of liquidity that is available to all, or more available.
So is that the fundamental change that we went from where it was easier to do everything custom because then you'd get exactly what you wanted, whereas today it's the complete opposite? Why passive investing and ETFs and futures have all grown so much because it's easier to do the non-custom?
Well, I would offer, and I'm interested in what others say, they probably disagree with me, but I would offer at the end of the day that is an outlet that you've had to go find. because the return you were getting in the ability to generate a return on the other became increasingly more difficult. Cost blew out. You know, I mean, if you talk to any of the FCMs in the room, and Antonio mentioned this, I mean, you got a clearance statement before with some of the cleared products. They were not the line items you have on there today. Now you have all these line items, you know, for regulatory purchases. And, you know, buy side sitting here and they're opening up and they're like, what am I paying for this for? I've never paid for that. It was embedded in the price. And that education process is requiring the new systems and things like that in order to track that and be able to make an educated decision. That, I mean, even if you look at CVS, I mean, I ran the CVS business for ICE when I first joined. You know, we have portfolio margining, like Nicholas talked about, for index versus single name. Perfectly replicated portfolio margining. You would think that would be very easy and the regulators would understand that. Well, Antonio and team had to go build their own model separate from the clearinghouse, have that approved, so they could prove to the SEC that they were able to manage the risk, even regardless of what we, the clearinghouse, might say, even though we were making a margin call at the end of the day. So that's an example of that, and that's still the case. So if you're a buy-side person, a buy-side entity, and you have, let's say, four or five sell-side institutions that you're docked with, you've got to review all four or five of those individual models in the world of CDS in order to make a decision of, like, what do I put this trade today? That wasn't there before. It was somewhat harmonious.
Yeah, I mean, I think if the large buy-side felt, the asset managers, the insurance companies, the DEMs, the real money guys who were clients of the banks felt that liquidity was being impaired, to Chris's point, they would do what is required to get direct access into these clearing venues so they could trade directly. But obviously, it's not. The liquidity has remained, and it's working its way through. It's just working its way through in the traditional channel now with some of these asset classes clearing.
I just want to close out the discussion around, you know, banks and non-banks. I think legacy ways of classifying firms, such as differentiating between all banks and all non-banks, are not as useful as they once were. I think everyone in the market is seeking to leverage technology. Everyone in the market is seeking to employ balance sheet in the most efficient way possible. And you have new entrants in areas of the market where one might not necessarily expect them. So, for example, taking Citadel Securities as an example, we have a CFTC registered swap dealer. We have a SEC registered broker dealer. We are a self-clearing member at LCH. We just entered the off-the-run treasury market, which is, you know, balance sheet intensive. So, I think historical sweeping generic categorizations are less useful than they once were as the market continues to evolve.
I mean, Citadel at this point is probably one of the hardest firms to put a label on now. I mean, what do you call yourselves? Or do you look at the two businesses separately, the buy and sell side businesses?
Well, again, and that's to my point. I don't think there's necessarily a need to try to, you know, apply a specific label. It's about, you know, providing liquidity to clients, adding value, and helping to spur market innovation.
Yeah, but Jonas, would you agree that without the changes we saw in the market, that opportunity might not be presenting itself? Because if everyone was being completely satisfied with the firms they had documentation in place with, the ability for you guys to knock on the door and present your case and offer that would have been exponentially more difficult.
Yeah, so I mean, we certainly agree, and this goes back to some of my earlier comments, that, take the cleared interest rate swap market, for example. The implementation of market reforms helped new entrants such as ourselves enter that market in the first place. So, you know, such as ensuring there are not discriminatory barriers to access on trading venues, that's kind of a requirement in order for new entrants to be able to get in the first place. Similarly, you know, the expansion of central clearing, helpful for new entrants and helpful for overall market liquidity. So we certainly agree that there are aspects of market structure that can promote liquidity and promote greater competition and new entrants coming into the space.
Yeah, there's nothing out there that prevents any of the traditional names that we're talking about to try some of these services. I'm sure, you know, much to the dismay of some of the traditional banks, that Citadel's been able to create inroads in certain asset classes when they thought they had this long-lasting relationship providing terrific services, and then, you know, in comes, you know, Jonah and the team, and they're providing a tighter price on a butterfly or a particular swap, and all of a sudden that information or that trade is going to Citadel and away from the traditional bank desk. You know, and arguably the same thing could happen in off the runs. I have to say it's been a long time since I've been able to compliment Citadel on a panel, and it feels somewhat over.
So on that note, John, I mean, I'd be remiss to not ask what your thoughts were on the potential Virtu KCC tie-up, and we don't have to talk about that particular deal. We don't even have to talk about that particular deal, but it's part of that, is the idea that consolidation in that space to build a bigger non-bank liquidity providers, for lack of a better way to call them, is a way
forward. Yeah, I think theoretically, if something like that were to take place, regardless of what we've all read in the last 24 hours, it brings together, whether it's those two names or other names, two very large players in the market, and now as an exchange operator and no longer at Virtu, it definitely will impact how we approach the various services that we're selling one of those firms or two other firms, and it affects us from, you know, the execution right through clearing, through market data, through colo, and all the exchanges on this panel know what that feels like. You know, sometimes for us, you know, the coming together of those two entities doesn't equal and add to top line revenue.
Yeah, I mean, does 1 + 1 in terms of liquidity equal 2 in that case, or is it more like 1.5 because there is overlap?
Well, probably it's less so because those companies were interacting probably with each other, and this is not going to be possible anymore. So it's a bit the point that I mean, for sure, the reason why there is this search for liquidity is because there is definitely a gap between what the market offers and what the final client wants. So the final clients are becoming bigger, they want to trade in size. What they see is a number of markets, not all markets, but most markets, where they can't do their size. Or they need to deal with that sort of problem. But if at the same time the amount of players in the market decreases, then you have that point on diversity, which is very important. The fact that in order to have a balanced market, in order to have a market that works, it needs to be balanced. You need to have a sum of players that are doing different things at the same time to create a perfect ecosystem. And if concentration goes too far, obviously you are losing that benefit, that advantage, and you could run into issues of liquidity. So there is always it's like a pendulum that goes from one side to the other. There is always an ideal number, and you know it moves.
Presumably, too much consolidation would new entrants would see that as an opportunity to come in, and then, like you said, the pendulum. Let's go back to the broader liquidity topic. The data that comes out of the regulators do a lot of studies, some of the banks do studies, will make the markets look as if liquidity is great, things are fine, it's as good as it's ever been. But when we go out and talk to the buy side, which I know is a sort of a big diverse group of folks in and of themselves, particularly about the bond market, which we obviously do all the time, and we ask them, has liquidity in the market impacted your ability to implement your investment strategy? 2/3, 75% will say, absolutely, yes, it has, and it continues to. So what's right? Is the data right, or is the perception of the buy side right, or is the truth really somewhere in the middle?
I think we touched on a little bit earlier, and I think it's very evident in the bond market that before they were accustomed to dealing with multiple different venues. When I say venues, you know, liquidity providers, sell side, whatever you want to refer to it as. They don't have the same access that they had to those relationships. It's been curtailed a bit. They've gone from 5, 6, 10, 12, now they're down. They have enough capital support, 3 to 5. And so they're getting prices from 3 to 5. Well, the 3 to 5 they're getting prices don't necessarily hold the inventory and all the names in the corporate bond market that a given buy-side institution in your question wouldn't necessarily want to have access to. And there is some issue that when they pick up the phone, they call their 3 to 5, and someone doesn't have the liquidity. Now that person is picking up the phone and calling someone else and saying, hey, where is the 6.5-year GE, this CUSIP number X? And all of a sudden there's now, especially in stuff that has a little bit of age on it, now there are things in the market that you cannot at the end of the day get access to. And you may have made that phone call thinking value was at this price. You sparked a little bit of interest in the call around market to try to find out where it is to service the client. Now the price has moved because I've gotten 4 phone calls today and something I haven't gotten a phone call on in a week. And now I'm chasing it a little bit. And so that's been the goal. We created a product called ICE Credit Trade in the marketplace. And we're seeing the dealer community use that at daily auctions in order to take advantage and right-size their portfolio where they are because of the lack of liquidity they see even on dealer quotes now. We're seeing that in the index CDS, the amount of dealer quotes that are available in the market has even though clearing in CDS is absolutely through the roof, the execution piece of it is beginning to find small holes that they need to fill in.
Yeah, it's a function of capital as well, Kevin. These banks were able to maintain the inventories they were able to maintain pre-crisis. To Chris's point, I think you'd have a wider group. It's not really a liquidity issue. It's sort of an inventory issue. So if you have the inventory and you could, you're managing your clients' expectations with what you have already on the balance sheet, then it would feel as if there isn't this call around and this. ICE obviously has a product that is working, but it's still in the corporate debt market. It's very thin. It's very still anachronistic in its way of discovery and execution. On the treasury side, and a platform that we have, which has now been rebranded as NASDAQ Fixed Income, there's just been a shift in market structure. You see how large banks who traditionally acted as the makers are now able to internalize a lot of their client flow with their interest rate swap book, with their mortgage book, with their agency book, with their futures book. And then when they build up a risk tolerance that they're no longer comfortable with, they'll exhaust out into the two platforms that currently exist. But in this periods that we're currently in low volatility, it's easier to get that exhaust done on the thicker stack than you might have had if you decided to distribute it more equally. And some of the routing technology in the interdealer space, certainly in the platform that we control, has not been working to our advantage. And I think the market participants are finally realizing that, it's gone far enough, because clients are demanding for better execution. And, until we get back to the clearing solution for this, we're kind of forced through this already discover and execute block with your bank, or your bank-like client, or with Citadel or others, and then it goes into an aggregator, and then it gets exhausted out into the one of the two venues.
I think it really depends, once again, on what is that buy side defining as liquidity? What is the market they're focusing on? And what market are they using? Like to my original point, if you look, we use open interest as a metric. As of 16th of February, the open interest in Treasury futures was 10 million contracts, an all-time record, which accounted for 80% of the cash market notional. So, what's wrong with it? You look at futures markets, it varies by region, it varies by asset class. In the US, year to date, interest rates futures are up 10%, FX futures are down 20%, energy futures are down 10%. So, what is it the asset class you're focusing on? Cash Asia Pacific markets are down anywhere between 30 to 40%, depending on which one you look at. So, depending on what you're focusing on, you're going to need different tools and different strategies to seek and extract liquidity from that market.
And is that where we are now? Is the market structure has fundamentally changed since the crisis? The market has finally accepted that what is today is and will be. So now we need to figure out not how to make it go back to how it used to be, but what can we do to innovate and adapt to make it work? And maybe the traditional models don't really work as well as they used to.
You can't go back to the past, and basically you need to innovate in very different ways. First of all, on the product line, the functionalities to help the clients find that liquidity. In the way we design those new functionalities, there need to be, I think from an exchange standpoint, a more synchronization with the whole market, whereby the exchange doesn't go, it's my way or highway, this is what you get, but the exchange needs to work with the client a buy side, a sell side, a proprietary trading firm to design that best environment for the trade to happen. And that's how you foster innovation, by the way. And finally, a very important bit in post-trade, obviously, because we all talked about capital. And this is really where it's the bottleneck of the financial markets. And whatever can be done to make the market more efficient in the post-trade, we give further opportunities to reduce the cost of capital of those trades. So I think it's a number of things that go together.
I think it's an interesting sign how big of a business for each of the exchanges data has become, right? And it's about using data to find liquidity, is that right?
Yes. Or to measure the liquidity that you have. Well, I mean, John brought up a point I was going to interject a moment ago. He talked about the client search for this, this best execution. Well, now it's a regulatory mandate that they need to prove that they have achieved that best execution. And, part of our investments in our data business there have been to provide those tools. So, obviously from a pre-trade perspective, you use the data to create an educated user who decides to take risk. We all have execution platforms we offer. They've executed on the platform, it's gone to the clearinghouse, now coming out the back end of that. You also have to understand what levels of risk I'm holding. What does that set me up for the next transaction that I need to do? Whether it's to, move the portfolio to the right or to the left based on whatever the risk metric they have there. And so look, in our ICE data services business with, the acquisition of IDC a couple of years ago, now we have liquidity metrics around corporate bonds. We have continuous evaluated pricing that wasn't available before. It's used by the entire market. Buy and sell sides there, and we've embedded some of that into our ICE credit trade auction. So, those all are different bits and pieces for someone to put together in a complete picture. Before, they just called their relationship. So, hey, how does this look? You came back. Here's the profile. Here's the relationship. Here's your bid offer. Great. I'm done. But now they're having to do that work on that side.
Yeah, and it's going to move on much further, I think, in the future. I mean, if you think that. Self-driving cars will be around in less than 10 years. So it's a huge challenge in the automotive industry in our day-to-day life. What could happen, in the world of financial markets? And that's basically about how do you use this data?
I think we ought to go straight to the end of the self-driving drones like they have right now.
But it's going to mean that you're going to need to integrate, you're going to need to use that data, and you're going to need to find that liquidity, helped by automated intelligence, and so on and so forth.
Yeah, alternative data, and then drones taking pictures of wheat fields or something, right?
Absolutely.
Kevin, just back to your question around market participants innovating to, find ways to improve market liquidity. I think the single name CDS market provides a great example. Chris can probably talk about this further, but there, the SEC hasn't even, finalized their rules to increase post-trade transparency or require dealer registration, let alone inventory clearing. But you've seen over the last year or so, market participants greatly increasing their voluntary clearing of single name CDS. And as a result, we've seen some liquidity providers re-enter the market who had previously exited, and just showing the impact that voluntary step has had on liquidity in single name CDS.
On the documentation process, the documentation process had become so onerous there that the only way for them to get access to those single names was to use the clearing infrastructure in order to work in that market, because now they're having access to a much larger pool of market participants.
Since it was brought up, I just want to throw out an opinion that I really appreciate the equity markets, that those who contribute to the market data feeds get part of the market data feeds. So I don't know if the exchanges want to take that in mind. That's a big question.
Yeah, I'm not responsible for market data at NASDAQ for all the right reasons, but it is an absolutely critical core business for us for a couple of reasons. The biggest being it's being demanded by the clients, and it's data that we have, and we give it to them. And yes, there are, you know, if it wasn't worth anything, they wouldn't be paying anything for it. They pay a lot for it. It's something that we want to innovate with our clients to help create a valuable data set of data products, not just in repiping out the data that's coming off of our various exchange matchers, but surveillance data in our smart technology. These are highly demanded products that are being pursued, and certainly something that is, I think, good for all of our businesses.
Yeah. It's the point being liquidity is much more than just an order book now, right?
The liquidity has morphed into consuming information, market data, understanding act times, understanding fill rates, understanding the importance of the depth of the book. All of these things are now commonplace, as opposed to just calling up someone saying, what's the bid offer and how much?
So we talked about this. Oh, Anthony.
I was going to say, and they won't go into the market data, pay, no pay, debate. Obviously, it's out of scope. But I do agree that I spent some time with Valerie there this week, and it's extremely powerful. When you have anonymized data from a series of FCMs, a series of broker dealers, right? You can profile that data, right? It's so powerful. Some of the stuff you guys are doing, it's amazing. You can go and, okay, this is the profile of this type of trader. I'm Mr. Regulator, you cannot tell me that that I was there in the market, because we were all running the same algorithm kind of thing, right? So it's very, very powerful.
Thank you.
You're quite cool.
So we talked about the structural changes and that it is here to stay and we need that innovation, but there is, and I assume there is, a cyclical component, low volatility, low volume, low interest rates, although in some cases some of those things are ticking up, it's still pretty much been the same way for a long time now. And how does that impact liquidity? Do we think that's cyclical, or is there some possibility that the VIX will always stay at 12 for the foreseeable future? I don't know, Keith, maybe you want to, from your point of view.
Well, I mean, we're already seeing volumes increase since November. Significant event happened then. So I think, yes, interest rates are going to go up. You're going to see more activity. You're going to see, I think, you might see more resting liquidity in listed markets. I think you'll see, the ability for more market participants to enter the market. At this conference, I mean, we've heard nothing but regulatory talk of how things may change. And I think you'll see if there are good regulatory changes, smart regulations, that you might see some of the, you might see some of the banks that are pursuing agency models might switch that to inventory risk and actually, the inventory credit risk pretty much, but they tend to hedge market risk.
Volatility is mean reverting, so it should come back to the average. And we've seen, if I take the example for instance of the Italian market, which LSE manages, a number of years where the volatility was very, very, very low, and we were getting preoccupied. The market was preoccupied because that has an impact, obviously, on the profitability of some players, and therefore it has impact on liquidity. But then this reverted. But what we saw is that we used that moment, that number of years when the market was out of favor, to really work with the clients and convince more market makers to join. And we succeeded to get 27 market makers on that specific market. The market has flourished in the last 3 years. Has been finishing the top of the volume growth in Europe every single year in the last 3 years. Now trading about 5 billion a day of euros. So I think it's kind of worked in waves, in phases. And one needs to use the different phases in the best possible way to prepare for the next one.
So many of us grew up in a market of information inequality. And that, for many years, provided certain spikes in what we would call liquidity, because there were measurable market moves in whatever asset class you decided to pick. But now we deal in an age of almost perfect information. I mean, everyone's dialed into economic releases and everyone has, all of the end users are using all of the respective exchange market data pieces, obviously the smart surveillance technology. And then you have a Fed and central banks that are shockingly transparent about what they're actually doing in terms of rates. And I say shockingly, not to be provocative, but you know, I remember a time where you'd have to wait around on a Friday to figure out what money supply data was to determine whether or not the Fed was going to be easing or tightening. And that provided certain momentums, whether it be in the interest rate product or the OTC product or the swap product, that has now been kind of wrung out of the market. I'm not suggesting that all of this has gone to algo-driven trading, but that sense of volatility because of perfect information, those little hiccups have been smoothed out. And that in itself presents a whole different set of issues for the exchanges.
Well, the market confidence in and of itself, right? I mean, everyone's feared. I mean, John brought up the Fed. I mean, the Fed's petrified if they raise rates that you know, the market was going to sell off, and the asset inflation we've seen with inequities that's taken place over the past 18 months or so, they raised rates, the market went up. I mean, I don't know what they were saying at the Fed that day, but that would have been a great conversation to be the fly on the wall.
I think you said, I was thinking about it, to your question about the VIX, I think there's so much uncertainty in the market, there's so much, almost saturation, right? And there's no volatility because of the AI. Otherwise, how can you explain that after the electoral shock in November, after the relative market rally, we're still waiting for a tax reform, reg reform, foreign policy reform, a foreign trade reform, geopolitical uncertainty, and the VIX is at 11%. There must be a point of saturation where volatility just dies because that's not what we're
the elections and Brexit and so on and so forth. So I mean, you're really in a time where you would think that the risk is there. So volatility is at very exceptionally low levels.
Yeah, for what and it's been nice. And we keep thinking it's good. The volatility has been a little bit volatile, but it still seems to always revert back.
Okay.
Great. So I have another question or two, but maybe we can open it up to the audience for some questions. Before we move on,
thank you. Eric Chern from CTC. So I appreciate all the comments from the panelists. So, it seems to me that, we have a panel on liquidity. I think there's like a general acceptance that there's less liquidity available in the markets today as a result of a lot of different factors, competitive issues, regulatory issues. Pressure on capital in the banks, which is filtering down to the through the clearing firms. I think there's some reason for to be encouured based on Acting Chairman Giancarlo's comments yesterday. Maybe I say nominated Chairman Giancarlo's comments. So there's maybe some reason to be encouraged. But then I think if we look at the trend, and we look at there's a lot of data we can look at. And certainly there's some exceptions, but you look at the number of SCMs, you look at the number of banks that are involved, the size of the banks, there's a lot more consolidation, there's concentration, there's fewer liquidity providers. Just in the last couple of weeks, we have Timber Hill saying they're getting out of the equity option market making business. This week, we have the KCG Virtu deal being announced. So the point being, there continues, I think, to be this trend, and so we see less liquidity. Now, on a daily basis, on a slow day in the markets seem to be very tight. Penny wide in certain issues, so certain people might say, I don't see the problem. The problem I see is that when we have the dislocation, so it's not the average day or even the median day, it's the 5% day, it's October 14 or August 15, and I think the trend is getting worse. Now, Chairman Giancarlo seems to see that, we see that. The question is, how do we get, what analysis can we do, what data can we present to demonstrate the severity of the problem, because I think the markets today are a lot more fragile than most people can see. And while some folks might be working on increasing liquidity, improving, some of the regulations, freeing up capital, as it stands today, we are in a fragile situation. And if we see a dislocation tomorrow, there's a lot less liquidity available to the end users. And so how do we demonstrate this effectively to the regulators so they can move more quickly to resolve the issues?
I think that, Eric, to your to your point, the regulators definitely understand that post-crisis they've put this floor in getting more and more product that had been responsible for the crisis into a clearinghouse. Managing the market risk like CTC does and other large firms who are in the audience do, you're being properly margined by your FCM or by your prime. You're managing your direct clearing relationships the way you do. So if you're a regulator, you're saying, you know what, if there was that 5% move, there shouldn't be any fundamentally wrong issues or anyone going out of business. But you know, you talk about, you know, August the 14th or the August 24th and 15th, you talk about these spike events with SNB, you talked about the flash rally. SNB obviously, a few firms were carted out, but the other large moves went somewhat kind of almost, yeah, huge volume days, but no one was getting really carted out, which tells me now as an exchange operator that the system is working. Yeah, the markets may have moved, but they may have overreached, they may have pulled back too much, there you have the flash, the 12 minutes of fury. You know, we had a joint staff report published about the thing to finally understand what happened in a market that shouldn't trade with any volatility, went absolutely haywire on this particular day. So it definitely gets people's attentions, but I think the politicians who are trying to legislate on some of these things are somewhat misguided. And hopefully the regulators with soon-to-be Chairman Giancarlo, certainly with his comments this week, will be putting a strong hand on the tiller at the CFTC to drive some of the things that we've all been talking about today, to continue these markets on its path. However, you know, we all believe in free markets, we all believe in open and transparent markets, and you know, Timberhill exiting, you know, equity option market making, I'm sure Tom Petterfy is a very smart and capable man, said, you know what, I'm not creating the return I like for this business, and I'm, you know, it's competitive and I'm exiting. And that's kind of how the market finds its bottom, it finds its equilibrium that way. You know, the banks were having some difficulty during the financial crisis. The non-banks were able to slide in and help during certain periods. Now we're managing equilibrium between bank and non-bank. Your point about, you know, liquidity just feeling like it's not there, if you want to put on a directional massive trade and something, yeah, you're going to move it, but you guys know better than anyone how far you're going to move it if you want to take dispositional risk. So.
Keith or Chris, I was going to say, you know, you were with O'Connor when Swiss Bank ejected the entire equity business after 3 years of flat, you know, flat earnings and equities, right? And you went off and you built CTC, which, you know, was a very successful story. Things change, and I think you see Timberhill's going to exit. Other firms have started building up and entering. There's a firm, I'm not going to give the name, but the firm in Chicago that started from nothing 5 years ago, and they're like the top three in options on futures. So, you know, we see that constant part of, you know, coming in and out of the ecosystem. It's just part of it.
Eric, I was going to add, I think it's a bit of a desire for the regulator to want to hear that story. If you look at the last 8-9 years, and we've been gone through this re-regulation coming out of the crisis in a way, there was no benefit for a regulator at the end of the day to say, that's good enough, that's enough regulation. It was very, very positive for regulators at that point in time to say, I think you guys have done really good work, but we probably need to add this other incremental piece. And that's what I did in the bill. I added the incremental piece. And if you look at that across the globe, I mean, until the election of the current administration, you didn't have anyone wanting to stand up and champion that, you know, the pendulum's gone too far. We'll see what happens in Europe and in Brexit when they manage through that and see if that attitude begins to change. Obviously, the elections that are taking place across the continent have a similar opportunity for that same level of impact. But there hasn't been an audience that's willing to hear that. I mean, even if you look at Basel, I'm sure that the banks in the room will tell you great stories about very logical, well thought out, incredibly detailed with all the data you could ever think about of why this is enough capital to hold, but that wasn't a conversation that was worth having at that moment in time. And so it's interesting to me, and I think I said a little bit earlier about the confidence. I think we begin to see that trend start to take shape, and people start to have a little bit of confidence that there are going to be new entrants to the market. There are, you know, I mean, the FCM thing, that's an issue. Obviously, you pointed it out, but that's all driven by economics at the end of the day. And you know, we've had muted interest rate environment for 10 years, yeah. Right? And that business model, the way it was constructed, from what we have known in history and in our careers, you know, fundamentally changed, and a lot of them held on as long as they could, and now we have to find what the new version of that looks like. But I'm encouraged by the comments the nominated chairman made, and I think it's consistent with the administration. I'm hopeful that begins to swing the pendulum back to some form of rationality.
I also think that there's, you know, an important distinction between flash crashes and price discovery. You know, if you have a big movement and there's continuous trading, is that really a flash crash? You know, it makes a great headline, it's sensationalist, but, you know, I don't see it always as a big movement thing, flash crash.
Maybe we'll take one more question.
Thank you. Mark Spanbrook with FIA APTA. I'd like to take it back to liquidity. The Europeans are developing an interesting regulation, and this is mainly to Chris and Nicola, whereby under the CCP, Recovery and Resolution Act, we will see that the possibility will come that they take variation and margin gains haircut away. So in fact, the prop trading shop will lose the gains, or partly the gains they have in variation margin, and the losses are still in place. Now, both gentlemen do really care about liquidity, but I think they're highly conflicted because their clearing houses are advocating that this is a good thing for the markets, that variation margin gains haircutting should be taken into account. So I guarantee you we're gonna see more illiquid markets, it's gonna be taken away, and obviously we need, as prop traders, to take care of the liquidity in the markets and talk to these gentlemen at today itself about non-providing liquidity due to their clearinghouse taking this view. So maybe Chris and Nicola can expand on them not being conflicted and see how they can actually solve this solution.
Don't flip a coin. But, you know, if 6 years ago you could have sat here and had the same exact conversation with the structures that we have in place around forced allocation at the end of the waterfall. Okay? And there's been a lot of education through that process to get to a point in the conversation of how do you cure for the recovery, right? I mean, resolution, we set that aside. That's going to be a regulatory event that goes through. It's got to apply fairly across the market, and you know, we'll see where that ends up. But to say that we're advocating for what is a market solution that can provide the greatest chance of recovery to stabilize the market. That is the ultimate goal. That's what we're advocating for. The tools that we put in that box from time to time change, and I think they continue to evolve. But we're also working within a number of, you know, you're saying that I'm conflicted. I think the conflict is not really with us internally as much as it is with the various regulators that have oversight on who our membership is. And those regulators have much different requirements in the day that they expect, especially the bank-held FCMs, and in Europe, even the non-bank FCMs, of what they have to be able to provide and have that. So we can get this to a point where there are no FCMs because no regulator is going to let them be in that business. I'm not exactly sure that's the part that you want to go to either, and that story is a bit difficult. But from our perspective, we're trying to find the most fair way in a point of that level, right? I mean, we're talking about tail risk that we've never experienced. And you get to that waterfall, it's all theoretical at that point in time. But to put a tool set in there that we have the very best chance to stabilize this market going forward. I'm sure we may have differences of opinion for what the best tool set is. Happy to have that conversation offline in the right place. But that's the ultimate goal.
I think on top of it, I mean, you've got definitely in Europe, MiFID II coming into place at the end of the year, and with some changes that could affect proprietary trading firms, such as capital requirements. And it's also a topic we're working on with the industry to kind of ensure that we are not losing another source of liquidity for our markets after the bank exiting, that would be really a drama to have you know, another category of liquidity providers to not provide their liquidity anymore. And so therefore we will be working and trying to influence as much as we can so that you know, we can ensure that the different parts of the market will be treated in the best possible way. So I think there is a lot of things that are coming in front of us that we need to work together, which is why I was really making the point of you know, this need of partnership with the different clients, because we are in front of a challenge, which is why the panel is called In Search of Liquidity. There is a challenge, but it's not an insurmountable challenge. It just needs more work together to resolve it.
That is a great positive note, I think, to end. Thanks to a great panel, and thanks everybody for coming.